looks like all my clever things that I normally do are just making it not work. So vegetable physiology, what is a vegetable anyway? Okay, so the main thing is to remember that fruit and vegetables are alive, and after harvest, they are continuing to ripen. So they change texture, color, flavor. They heal damage. They fight disease. So this is a sweet potato, and after it has healed that injury, it will fight off rots and diseases. They will respond to their environment. So you can see that it's a green onion, has bent around because it's been stored flat, and so it bends because it's trying to grow upwards and find the sun, and so it will grow. And likewise, like sweet potatoes and potatoes will develop shoots. Again, they're trying to grow another plant. The most important thing is that they are continuing to respire, and this is respiration is what fuels all these changes within fruit and vegetables. So this involves using oxygen and releasing carbon dioxide. Just as we do, fruit and vegetables need to effectively breathe. So lettuce, it does the same thing. And because respiration is what provides the fuel that keeps fruit and vegetables alive, we can think of it as being a little bit equivalent to storage life. So things that make respiration rate go up, so as storage temperature increases, respiration rate increases, and storage life goes down. So the faster fruit and vegetables are using their stored energy reserves, the faster they're going to effectively die or senesce, and that's the end of their storage life. So this process is using sugars, but also lipids and fats and other fuels within the product, combining that with oxygen to make energy, carbon dioxide, and water. So this was actually the topic of my PhD, was the relationship between respiration rate and storage life of fresh products. And it came from this observation that the total number of heartbeats were similar for a mouse and an elephant during their lifespan. And so if you can measure heartbeats, in this case, respiration rate of fresh produce, then that can indicate how long that fruit or vegetable will live. So, okay, so now we go back to, you know, what are the different parts of fruit and vegetables, and how are they going through these processes? So, of course, just like us, fruit and vegetables are made of cells. It's the pressure inside those cells that is making them crisp, keeping them turgid. And so, you know, can snap a piece of celery because the cells are still crisp, full of liquid. If the cells are broken, then those liquids leak out. So the whole product will become soft. It will be susceptible to rots and disease, and the cell contents mix and turn brown. So I've just got a slide which shows how this happens. So this is a diagram of a cell. We have the cytoplasm, which is where all the mitochondria and chloroplasts and all these other bits and pieces are. And inside the vacuole are different compounds, phenolic compounds. Now, what happens when you crush a cell is that you allow that these membranes rupture and the contents mix. And this allows this polyphenol oxidase enzyme to combine with orthoquinone, and together they further oxidize and they form melanin. So melanin is the brown product that you get in your skin. It's the same product. And that is what causes a damaged fruit or vegetable to have a bruise, to have an injury. You can see on these mushrooms, just from touching them, you've bruised the cells, the contents mix, and you get this browning reaction. So that just shows how important it is to handle fruit and vegetables gently. So as we're saying, fruit and vegetables, they need to breathe. They have these cells inside. Gases have to move in and out of the product and between those cells. So how do they get inside the fruit or vegetable? They move through stomata. So this is stomata, which are on leaves, and also lenticels. Now, the difference is that stomata are very tiny and the plant opens and closes them, whereas lenticels are larger and they just stay open. But the key point for us in post-harvest management is that the number of holes on the fruit or vegetable skin affects how easily it will lose moisture. So here we have something like a leaf has a huge number of stomata across it, you know, 60,000 per square centimeter. Whereas if we think of these other mature products, they have lenticels and they're large, but there are not so many of them. You can see them quite clearly. So these little bumps on cucumbers, or you can see these dimples on a lemon, those are lenticels. So they are the breathing holes for the product. Now, the one group that doesn't have any of these are the, well, Solanaceae. So capsicums or peppers, tomatoes, eggplants, that whole Solanaceae family, they don't have lenticels or stomata. And that is why they are much more resistant to water loss than many other products. So, okay, what is a vegetable for? We can think, well, for us, it's just something to eat. But for a plant, they represent something quite different. Vegetables can obviously be any or all parts of the plant. So here we have our ideal plant that produces every sort of vegetable that you could want. It has fruit like a pumpkin or a squash. It has leaves. It has leaf bases. It has tubers like sweet potato, carrot, taproot, potato, stem tuber, onion as a bulb, celery, petiole, leaf buds, seeds, and so on. But the point of thinking about this is that what they are on the plant affects how easily we can handle them and store them, because some are made to survive and grow a new plant, like a sweet potato or potato. They were always made to be apart from the parent plant. They can survive quite okay on their own. Whereas if we think of fruit, the whole purpose of fruit is to be eaten. And the reason they want to be eaten is so that they can spread the plant's seeds. So these are things like corn and beans, tomatoes, squash. Now, many of these we actually eat very immature before the seeds form properly. But from the plant's point of view, they're trying to develop. So there's all these things are happening when you harvest that product. And that's why we need to slow it down so that we can store it for longer and get it to market. And then we have the final group, which are just on the road to death. They're not designed to be apart from the plant at all. So these are leaves, flower buds like broccoli, because broccoli is really a flower head, and things like lettuce, which is just a group of leaves. And this affects how easily we can transport, handle, and store those products. Now, when we think of vegetables, many vegetables are also fruit. But even if they're not, they still respond to the gas called ethylene. And ethylene is released by many fruit as they ripen, especially many tropical fruits release large amounts of ethylene. Ethylene can also be released by things like rotting vegetation, petrol motors, smoke, etc. When we think of fruit, ethylene can be a good thing because it will help them ripen. But in the case of vegetables, all the effects are bad. Ethylene causes yellowing, overripening, disease, reduced storage life, bitterness of carrots, speckling of lettuce, all sorts of things. So to reduce the effects of ethylene, what can we do? The first thing we can do is to reduce temperature with cold rooms, for example. So at cold temperatures, fruit and vegetables release less ethylene and are less sensitive to ethylene. So it's a win-win, really. There's less of it about and they're less sensitive. The other key thing that needs to be done is to remove sources of ethylene. So it's things like not leaving rotten fruit in the cold room, especially, or in the packing area, not having petrol engines running just outside that packing area or the cold room, not storing ripening fruit with unripe fruit, leafy green vegetables, broccoli, etc. So we don't want those. So in the end, this is, if you store ripening fruit like passion fruit, are one of the biggest emitters of ethylene that there are. Passion fruit are huge. You store passion fruit with a leafy green vegetable, and this is the result. It will cause premature yellowing. So